Steps towards axing the mega polytech Te Pūkenga have begun, but unions say the government has no plans, costings or details for what will replace it. Splitting up the institution, created by Labor 3 years ago, is part of National's 100-day plan. Kushla Norman reports.
Welcome to Te Pūkenga.
A polytech mega merger 3 years in the making. Nearly $100 million spent and jobs cut in the process. Now Te Pūkenga's to go, the minister's written to the sector, but what will replace it?
Why would you go out and tell staff, tell the board in a letter of expectation, we don't want you, we don't want a national network, but not have a plan of what you do want?
We are going to go through a consultation process with both communities and also the individual campuses, so I certainly have some thoughts on where we might go.
National was always opposed to Te Pūkenga. The amalgamation of 16 polytechs and 9 industry training organisations under one management. It has about 270,000 students and 13,000 staff. The idea was Labor's, to save money and avoid duplication in a sector that was needing government bailouts.
So this is the circuit breaker that I think people are looking for.
He denies the scrapping is a blemish on his legacy.
No, not at all. I mean, I think the current government's decision to go backwards is, you know, really disappointing.
But the merger did face backlash, including at the Southland Institute of Technology, where Penny Simmons was chief executive.
So I think it is for her an undoing of what she saw as a great wrong to the sector. But the problem with that is there are 270,000 students now caught up in indecision, in confusion.
I'm undoing it because it is losing money, it is going to continue to lose money, and it is going to require significant money to try and put in place the things that were going to make centralisation work.
The Union for Backroom Staff at Campuses says many will leave because they've had enough of change.
It's really upsetting and distressing to see all the effort that's gone into building something that would be better is just going to be thrust to one side for who knows what.
A sector that's had a rocky few years facing instability once again.
All right, Kushla, let's take this forward. What happens next?
So there will have to be a law change to undo Te Pūkenga. The Minister, Penny Simmons, she expects that actually unravelling the organisational structure of this won't be done until late next year. Now, there is a lot of work that will need to be done to work out what the future model looks like, but students, they can continue to study as normal. Staff are expected to be supported during this phase, but there are questions over what this means for jobs. The unions want to meet with the Minister, Penny Simmons. We asked her twice if she was willing to meet with the unions. She avoided committing to that, but is willing to meet with other groups like students, teachers and other communities. Now, the tertiary education sector, it's been through a lot in the past 3 years, a lot of reform. And the union tells me one piece of key feedback its members tell it is they're just sick and tired of change. But it looks like more of that is certainly on the cards.
I te whanganui a tara in Wellington. Kushla Norman, thank you. The under pressure police commissioner insists he's still the right man for the job, despite a stern letter from his new minister calling for a shift in approach. Andrew Costa says he agrees with the new direction and believes the public still have confidence in the police. Mikey Sherman reports.
Gangs behaving badly, ram raids and youth crime rates. The police minister's seen enough, and in this four-page letter, let's rip on the commissioner, laying out in black and white everything going wrong and everything that must change.
I thought that it was a very good idea in terms of having a reset, putting a line in the sand, making sure that the commissioner's was very clear in terms of our expectations as an incoming government.
The letter was very clear, but actually the things that are in it are the things that we believe need to shift.
The expectation is to wind back the woke, something National accused Andrew Costa of almost immediately after he was appointed in 2020.
He wants to be nuanced, he wants to be woke. Very woke, nuanced approach to crime.
Held up as an example of the recent policing style, anti-mandate protesters being allowed to set up camp for weeks outside Parliament.
The public surveys that have been done shows that there has been a loss in public confidence in the police. The commissioner is in charge of the police.
I don't think I would say I feel safe, especially at night time.
I don't think they have enough resources.
A higher presence would be better.
I don't think that they're too soft.
I think they're doing as good a job as they can do.
The letter discusses the government's first 100 days, a crackdown on gangs, including banning gang patches. The minister's saying he expects police to be using the full force of the law and wants strong and decisive leadership to address his concerns about the decline in public confidence.
Do you have confidence in the police commissioner?
Well, I was very public and I had lost confidence.
The commissioner says surveys show public support for police is at 70%.
Should you stay in the role if you only have 70% support?
Well, 70% is an incredibly high level of trust and confidence by international standards. I believe I've got what it takes to do this job.
He's assured me, after having read that document, that he can lead the police service in the direction that we need to go.
A new direction for police now officially underway.
That was a stern letter from the Minister, Mikey. Can Andrew Costa really stay on?
Andrew Costa was left with two options today. One, get on board, or two, get out of the way. Now, I understand that his tenure as police commissioner is set to expire in April of 2025. I asked him today if he considered stepping down any earlier, and he said no. I understand that Andrew Costa and his entire executive team met with the police minister today. I'm told it was a productive meeting, and in fact that both the police minister and the police commissioner agreed to release the letter publicly together. Now, that won't be the only letter of its kind doing the rounds with heads of government departments and organisations, and that's because this is a new government and they have a very, very new direction than the former government. That being said, ouch, it still hurts, it is brutal, and we saw that on Andrew Costa's The Face today.
Tēnā koe, Mikey, thank you for that. As protests continue across the country, the New Zealand Parliament's called for urgent steps to be taken to achieve a ceasefire in the ongoing Israel-Gaza conflict. But some feel we need to be taking a stronger line. Here's senior political reporter Benedict Collins.
A powerful performance for those at Parliament supporting Israel, some objecting to a ceasefire.
No way. You don't make a ceasefire with terrorists. You get rid of them. Period.
We need to support Israel in this crisis.
Not far away, those supporting Palestinians had gathered.
In support of a total ceasefire in Gaza, because what is happening there is effectively genocide.
We need more than ceasefire as well, not just ceasefire. Like, the buildings are still broken, no food, no water.
Urging our politicians to call for a ceasefire.
Free Palestine! Free Palestine!
Inside Parliament, they were doing just that.
Call on all parties involved in the conflict, as well as countries with influence in the region, to take urgent steps towards establishing a ceasefire.
Some politicians were appalled at Israel.
But bombing and killing and slaughtering women and children who have nothing to do with this other than have been born as a Palestinian. That is outrageous.
We have seen the bombing of hospitals. We're seeing the bombing of homes, refugee camps, schools, churches, for goodness sake. That's not self-defence.
Others attacked Hamas.
2 million people are being held hostage in Gaza right now by Hamas. A murderous dictatorship akin to ISIS.
As for the war in Ukraine, the new Prime Minister's not sure if he'll be expelling the Russian ambassador after all.
You would have given the Russian ambassador the boot here.
Correct. For us, it's just about keep the pressure on.
That war still rages, and now he's in charge.
When will you be expelling the Russian ambassador?
Again, look, we'll take advice on that, and that's something that our foreign minister will look at.
But why hesitate?
Again, our foreign minister, in fairness, having just been appointed, we'll get round that brief.
Perhaps the pressure's now on the prime minister to follow through. Benedict Collins, One News.